be there. This is a good opportunity for me to share with you some discussion about this recently described, at least in the ICU, asynchrony. First of all, my conflict of interest. I work for for a French company, Helical Medical System, to develop a new solution for ventilation during cardiopulmonary resuscitation, but there is no other direct conflict of interest with my presentation this morning. Mechanical ventilation and reverse triggering is not new, but this typical asynchrony is frequently unrecognized, as mentioned in the title of this paper that we reported in CHEST 3 years ago with the group of Laurent Bouchard and Geneva. When you look at this pressure recording in an ARDS, obtained in an ARDS patient, the respiratory rate, the insufflation time looks very regular. And I don't know, but at the first view, it could be something like controlled mechanical ventilation, passive mechanical ventilation. But looking much more in detail, you have some alterations, some modification of the pressure from one breath to the other. And when you look at the esophageal pressure tracing that permits to directly assess the respiratory effort, you can observe that there is a huge spontaneous effort occurring one breath every two breaths. And interestingly, you can see that the inspiratory effort start after the breath, the cycle was delivered by the ventilator with a delay that is constant among the different cycles indicated on the slide. This is reverse triggering. Why we call that reverse triggering? It's just because this spontaneous activity is triggered by the ventilator instead of what we observe usually with assist control ventilation, during which this is a spontaneous respiratory activity that triggers the ventilator. Frequently unrecognized, and to be honest, the first description we made in the ICU in Geneva was accidental. I was working with Laurent on APRV, on spontaneous ventilation, and I was surprised that during APRV, I observed in some patients systematically a spontaneous activity occurring at the upper pressure. And then we understood, by changing the mode of ventilation and by observing the spontaneous activity using an esophageal balloon or, on this slide, the electrical activity of the diaphragm, that again, this activity, spontaneous activity, occur very regularly after the beginning of the controlled breath delivered by the ventilator, and not, definitely not triggered by the patient. So it's something very interesting, because it's real spontaneous ventilation. But it's a spontaneous ventilation that follows the activity of the ventilator, which is uncommon. And again, difficult to recognize. Maybe a very important point is that this reverse triggering may occur at different ratio, different rhythm. In this example, it's a pressure ventilation, pressure target ventilation, and you can see that the reverse activity occurs every cycle delivered by the ventilator at a ratio 1:1. In this second example, with volume target mode of ventilation, the spontaneous activity assessed by esophageal balloon occur only one cycle every 2 cycles. And it's interesting because my experience, it's much easier to recognize reverse triggering when the ratio is 1:2, 1:3, or 1:4 compared to 1:1. Because 1:1, every breath are the same, so it's probably much more difficult to observe if you don't have the direct assessment of spontaneous breath using your electric activity or esophageal balloon. The other very particular characteristic of reverse triggering, also called entrainment, is the variation of the respiratory rate or the variation of the total duration of the duty cycle. You can see here the coefficient of variation of the cycle duration, that means the variation of the respiratory rate, during assist controlled ventilation in our patient without reverse triggering. You can see that there is 30% of variation, just that means that the respiratory rate, the respiratory drive, is changing along the time, with a variation of almost 30%. On the opposite, during controlled mechanical ventilation, without any spontaneous ventilation, of course, the variation of the respiratory rate is zero. It's just the timing of the ventilator to deliver the breath according to the respiratory rate. Interestingly, the reverse triggering is a spontaneous activity that, remember, follow the ventilator. So the variation of the cycle duration of the respiratory rate is very close from zero from the ventilator and very different from the normal variation of the respiratory rate of during spontaneous ventilation. In this paper, we reported a small series of IRBS patients, 8 patients, and the time duration of entrainment according to the different recordings were very different from one patient to the other, from 10 minutes to just some isolated reverse triggering. So it's not easy to know exactly how it occurs and for how many times it may occur. Interestingly, we observe in this series of patients reverse triggering or entrainment in both pressure target mode and also during volume target mode of ventilation. Again, it's important because the pattern is very different. During pressure target mode of ventilation, you can see that the reverse spontaneous activity amplified by the esophageal pressure prolonged a little bit the duration of the breath, thus increasing the tidal volume. So for me, the most important clinical consequence that we can expect with the reverse triggering is a risk of tidal volume increase. What happened in with the volume target mode of ventilation? The spontaneous activity with a ratio of 1:2 in this 1:1 in this part of the picture. You can see something that Bob Kaczmarek previously described in his presentation, which is, looks like a double breath, a double cycle or double triggering. There is no expiration in between the first and the second cycle, so the result is a huge increase of tidal volume. And remember, It may occur at 1-1 or 1-2 ratio during sometime 10 or much more minutes. So this pattern of reverse triggering with double cycles is very important to recognize and much more simple. As discussed with Bob, it's difficult to make the difference with what was previously described as a double triggering. This is a double cycle due to a reverse activity. You can see here the esophageal pressure swing, and you can see that the first cycle is not triggered by the patient. This is why the esophageal pressure starts to increase. It's a passive insufflation from the ventilator. The second breath occurs because of this reverse spontaneous activity. And it's important to keep in mind that the result is a double cycle, but it fits with an ALS patient with sedation with very low respiratory drive, which is completely different from what was usually described for double triggering. Double triggering is a completely different physiopathology, as described by Bob in the previous lecture. This is the esophageal pressure swing, and you can see that the double triggering, this is the spontaneous contraction of the respiratory muscle that triggers both cycles, the first one and the second one. This is a huge inspiratory effort, triggering not one, but two consecutive breaths without expiration. This patient frequently have very high respiratory drive, and sometimes very short duration of the cycle set on the ventilator. But again, if the result is the same, the physiopathology is completely different. And it's interesting because probably when you look at the literature of asynchrony, there is many double cycle that was really reverse triggering but unrecognized. This is an example in a recent paper reported by a French group dealing with neuromuscular blocker agent in ALDS. You can see on the left part of the panel the airway pressure, the esophageal pressure, and you can see that the swing of esophageal pressure occurs immediately after the peak pressure, which is typical of a reverse triggering, but not easy to recognize again, because it changed a little bit the waveform of the pressure and the peak, but not so easy to recognize. After injection of NMDA, this swing of esophageal pressure disappears, the reverse triggering disappears, and you can recognize the plateau pressure without any longer spontaneous activity. So again, not so easy to observe, to detect, to recognize at the bedside. Another example, very close from the previous one, done by Jean-Luc Dill from Paris, before NMBA or after NMBA. The rhythm is very regular, but you can see only an artifact of the expiration tracing that disappears after administration of NBA. So, again, not easy to recognize. What about the physiopathology of reverse triggering? Not so easy to understand. Reverse triggering has been described after lung transplantation. And we recently reported with Stéphane Delisle and my colleagues of ANSI, Dominique Savary, two cases reported in the Blue Journal of reverse triggering occurring in brain dead patients after resuscitation of cardiac arrest. This is the first tracing, 1-2 ratio, with a typical tracing of the airway, and the second one with electric activity that assess the reverse triggering activity.
So it's very important because it means
that the physiopathology don't come from the brain, but probably from a spinal reflex involving maybe stretch receptor in the thorax. So my conclusion, it's much more question than conclusion. Incidence in the generalized EU population of reverse triggering is very difficult to know at that time. There is potential risk associated with reverse triggering, and mainly the risk of high tidal volume. The exact mechanism is still under debate, but probably spinal reflex, and we can discuss that. The impact of ventilatory sitting, sedation is not known, but probably important. And last, the meaning of reverse triggering is not so easy to understand. Is it bad? Is it good? Because it's some spontaneous ventilation, it's sometimes good, but again, there is some risk. So I don't know if it's really bad and is open to discussion. I thank you very much for your attention.